as a chief scientist, what kind of developments were you tracking with interest of the Ukraine war?
You know, you're right, we are watching the Ukraine. In many ways, it's a great experiment that you know, allows us the opportunity to learn about Russian tactics, as well as performance of both their systems and their people. Mm-hmm. So it's still, you know, fluid. So I think it will take a little bit of time before we, you know, we fully analyze what has happened and we draw the right conclusions and so on. It's also, you know, while we're learning, it's also very specific to the kind of the region and that particular conflict. Mm. So I do think there are some conclusions we can draw. So in terms of some specific points, you know, something that we kind of we always know, but perhaps it always catches us by surprise, is, you know, how much interoperability matters. Mm. You know, we always try to think about, even, you know, even within our forces, how we will collaborate with within the different services, how the Air Force will play with the Army, with the Navy, with the Marine Corps. It's much harder when you have to interoperate in an alliance. And it's even harder when you have to interoperate with an ally that is not part of NATO. You know, kind of that realization is that, you know, we need to be thinking interoperability first, not last, which is typically what we do. Mm. So I think that's one of the things that that we're learning. The other thing that we're learning, and again, this shouldn't be a surprise, is that, you know, cyber is playing a much bigger role in this conflict than perhaps, you know, we've seen in the past. It gives us a sense for what a fully fledged cyber war might look like, and in particular because Russia has used this kind of the cyber aspect so strategically in the past. I mean, in the case of Ukraine, you know, they have done, I think, a very successful misinformation campaign over a number of years. But what we see play out there is that, you know, Ukraine learned a lot from the 2017 cyber attack that Russia, you know, inflicted on them. Mm-hmm. So this is one of the things that, you know, these conflicts do. I mean, they reveal your tactics, therefore, you know, the opposition can get better at it. I think, you know, given their experience from 2017, the Ukrainians were much better postured to defend themselves. Another thing that we're seeing is the push that we have in the Air Force for ACE, for Agile Combat Employment, which is really the strategy of dispersing our ability to generate sorties and generate power. That is something that has been proven out again in Europe. It enables our forces to conduct operations much faster and the higher levels of complexity from all distributed solutions. Another thing that perhaps was a surprise is, you know, high-end weapons like the hypersonics, like Kinzhal, that Russia has deployed, really they don't make that much difference unless you have them at high numbers, which they don't have. We also saw that, this was quite amusing, that one of them came back and hurt some Russians instead of Ukrainians, which was... The other thing that I would point out is that I talked about interoperability, but, you know, that is enabled by communications. You know, right. Absent communications, it's really hard to interoperate. Looking at the way that Russians have failed at that is underlying the importance of having the pervasive and very secure and robust communications infrastructure. And again, another amusing thing is that they actually went ahead and destroyed the cellular network in the Ukraine that their own secure communications depended on. So once they've done that, then they had to communicate in the clear, which obviously makes it a lot easier to figure out where they are.
I see.
That made it a lot easier for the Ukrainians to respond in kind. So I think that these are some of the you know, some of the kind of lessons. I think another one, which perhaps is a little surprising, is how in a conflict like this, kind of commercial companies can actually make a contribution, even though they're not part of the actual combatants. So, you know, a company called Maxar, they produced stunning imagery, you know, in the days and hours even before the invasion actually started. Elon Musk has been providing Starlink terminals to the Ukrainians to give them an additional way of maintaining communications. So, you know, this is perhaps the first time that we've seen commercial companies being not exactly direct combatants, but participating really actively in enabling operations by others.
Is there kind of a different approach happening in the Indo-Pacific?
I think a big, a very important difference is that luckily we don't have a conflict in the Indo-Pacific. So not in that yet. Sense, they are very different, and I would very much hope that we keep it that way. Said that, I think there are kind of insights that learning from that conflict that we can also, as we think about what the conflict here might look like, although this is a much more complicated and a very different environment. You know, cyber. You know, China is a master, I think, at using cyber to spread disinformation. China practices broadly what are called digital authoritarianism better than anybody else. And they're not only good at doing it themselves, but they're good at exporting it. So that gives them an opportunity to shape the information environment in which we will have to fight. And that's something that we need to think deeply and be very proactive in how we counter it. I think the similarities and the differences really depend on the contest. And the contest here in the Pacific is a little different. We really have a challenge in trying to preserve regional stability here. We, we believe that, the PRC utilizes actively gray zone activities to further its ambitions. What we've learned from the last two decades really of air operations, including this recent visit by Nancy Pelosi in the region, that they really are willing to undertake costly gray zone air activities for protracted periods. Another challenge here that is very unique is the relationship between our posture and the tyranny of distance. China operates from home base, a large landmass. Mm-hmm. We are far away. In order to be able to be successful here, we really depend on this network of allies in the region. So this notion of interoperability is so much more important here than in Europe. The other thing, frankly, that is a significant concern to us is the pace and scope of PLA expansion. If you look at the rate of production, of military system production that the PRC is executing on, it really looks like it's almost a wartime footing. It's a rate of production that really we've not seen in the United States since the last war, when we shifted production from industrial to military production. Mm-hmm. So I think that kind of scaling is something that presents an ongoing challenge to us. Really, I think, creates a lot of concern in our side of the water about the future here in the region and posture. Finally, the other truth, and we've heard this in the last couple of days here loud and clear, is the interconnectedness. China and the United States and our allies are so interconnected through the supply chain, capital markets and so on, that when you think of the possibility of the competition sliding into conflict, it will be almost like to separate Siamese twins, right? It's going to be very, very difficult to imagine a world where the two are completely separated. The repercussions of that on economies, the economic security and so on are, I think, too complicated to fathom.
If I could perhaps ask you, Dr. Coleman, of from your perspective on Korea, specifically as it relates to Korea and the U.S.
Well, so I think, first of all, and perhaps I'm stating the obvious here, but Korea matters in the world stage. I mean, it's a small country, but it's the 10th largest economy in the world. So Korea punches way above its weight. And I know this is a matter of debate within within Korea, defensive capabilities. We believe that security comes through strength. I don't know when it was, last time weakness disincentivized aggressors. Aggressors like weakness. I'm speaking as Victorian. I'm not representing the U.S. government on this point, but I think a thriving Korea, we need to be also a strong Korea, a Korea that can defend itself, both with gear, if you like, that you have here, but also through alliances. I think maintaining a balance so that the contest with North Korea does not slide into conflict requires security through strength. And coupled with both the alliances but also the very capable industrial base here in Korea, I personally believe that there is a great opportunity to posture the country in such a way that it contributes not only to the world economy but also to world security by virtue of its posture.
Great, thank you.